As the procurement for high-frequency rail continues, the anticipation increases as we are waiting to see what the future of passenger rail might look like in the corridor. On January 24, 2023, something slightly unexpected happened. Alstom, Quebec City's mayor Bruno Marchand, and Montreal's mayor Valérie Plante made public statements to support and bring attention onto Alstom's vision of how high-speed rail could be the next step forward, building upon the procurement for high-frequency rail. It's important to note that most of what follows is extrapolated from a presentation made by Alstom in November 2022, as part of their comments and submission for the HFR request for expression of interest. High-frequency rail is currently calling for a maximum service speed of 200 km an hour. However, the federal government has somewhat acknowledged that they would be interested in studying proposals that can achieve higher speeds, assuming they can deliver increased socioeconomic benefits and value to Canadians. The following slides and their content were released on January 25, 2023 by High Speed Rail Canada, an advocacy and education group focused on the promotion of such projects in Canada. Alstom's plan would be to operate a high-speed network between Quebec City and Toronto, with intermediate stops in various communities that are to be served by high-frequency rail. The plan relies on the ability to build a dedicated passenger rail corridor with sections that can operate at speeds of up to 300 km an hour, bringing it in line with modern high-speed lines in Europe. In the more complex part of the alignment, lower speeds would apply. Strategically choosing segments to upgrade can have a very noticeable impact on travel times, without resulting in increased cost of building an entire alignment to high-speed standards. For example, Montreal-Toronto would take 3 hours, and Montreal-Quebec City just over an hour and a half. Most trips along the corridor would fall right into the sweet spot, where traveling on high-speed trains is competitive and generally results in considerable uptake for passenger rail at the expense of flying and driving. This also supports the objectives of reducing greenhouse gas emissions, as the lines would be electrified. To maintain existing local services, Alstom proposes that high-speed and high-frequency services could coexist on the same tracks. This is alike what is done on Amtrak's Northeast Corridor. ASL high-speed trains, Northeast Regional intercity trains, and various commuter services between Boston and Washington, D.C. coexist throughout the alignment. Track priority is generally given to ASL high-speed trains, while other services stop at most stations and have lower priority. It is unclear exactly how Alstom visualized the service pattern in the corridor and whether some service would operate as express trains and skip certain stations. As Alstom is one of the largest rolling stock manufacturers, it is not surprising that they are offering one of their own design. Avilia Liberty train sets, the same variant to be introduced in the Northeast Corridor later this year, would offer a relatively low-risk option as the model is based on the proven design and the platform used throughout the world. The modern train sets feature active tilting, which allows for higher speeds and comfort in curves and can reach service speeds of 300 km with tilting active. Even though the price tag is most likely higher than the one for high-frequency rail, Alstom believes it would enhance the socioeconomic benefits further and bring the corridor closer together. At the end of the day, a lot of it comes down to the perceived value by the government. Does high-speed rail justify its additional costs by delivering more socioeconomic benefits to Canadians? Only time will tell. Alstom also elaborates on what the alignment for such a network could look like. As with HFR, there is a lot of questions about the alignment through Montreal and Toronto, as space is rather limited to add additional dedicated tracks up to the downtown core. From their presentation, the network would terminate at Union Station and would likely go through the Canadian Pacific, Havelock and Belleville subdivision, as well as the Metrolinx Don and Bala branch. In Montreal, Alstom is already suggesting that a downtown stop such as Gare Centrale would likely not be ideal, instead proposing a Gare du Nord to be located north of Mont-Royal with connections to the metro and potentially the RAM. This would avoid the considerable time and cost of building a new tunnel, while maintaining the travel time benefit from the more direct alignment. The alignment in Quebec, Trois-Rivières, Peterborough, and Ottawa builds upon existing tracks that were already indicated as a likely alignment for HFR. While we are excited that such a proposal is seen as viable by at least one of the private partners, there is a lot of questions that remains to be answered. For example, can the project share existing rail corridors in the most populous areas and achieve reliable travel times? What would be the total cost of such a project? And is the government and private and partners interested in guaranteeing funds for such an endeavor? Are Alstom travel time estimates realistic or optimistic? It might be too early to tell for many of those questions. Ultimately, the decision will be made by the federal government and their choice of a private partner and design. We do hope that they will properly consider the additional socioeconomic benefits and various studies that have suggested the possibility and benefits of high-speed rail in Canada. As more details and other proposals for high-frequency rail become public, it will be interesting to see what the future of passenger rail could look like in Canada. And we hope to have more details to share with you in the future. In the meantime, make sure to subscribe to Rail Fans Canada so you do not miss our future content.